Morning.
Good morning. Half a day from snowy Colorado.
Ooh.
How's that, Jay? Wow. I just want you to run outside and pick that branch one time.
Do some angels.
Angels. Trust me, my wife wants me to go out there and kick the branch because she said it's going to break.
So I know we're
you probably don't know, but there's a winter storm that delayed, you know, thousands of flights here in Denver's International Airport.
Wow.
And the storm goes all the way up to Wyoming, and it's heading towards Chicago from what we understand.
And so you guys are kind of like in South Denver at the bottom end of the storm. Obviously, it's brought a lot of snow, but I don't know anything about Denver weather. Is this like a lot of snow for this time of year or what?
Well, it's a lot of snow for Denver. And generally speaking, March is the wettest snow that we get. And any of the snow that comes previous to March is generally dry snow, very easy to shovel. A shovel that we were gonna, you know, probably weighs 8 pounds on average versus, you know, a few ounces if it's not in a March snowstorm, for example.
Right. And I know that the wife is on you to go shovel the driveway after this interview. So let's kind of get into it. You know, I wanted to, you guys offer a lot of different great, I call them mahalang products, right? For just, I mean, whether or not you're in Guam or living in the States. Applegui collection. I mean, you guys have everything from little handheld kumzus to books to this Chamorro Cuisine cookbook, which I think is a really great product because it really memorializes like the culture through cooking in a format that I think is just it's an awesome format. It's a great production, really. The book from cover to cover, the photographs, the recipes. I mean, having to just kind of settle on what would be like the definitive recipe for so many Chamorro dishes. I mean, that probably was just a work in itself, right?
Yeah, my wife can probably explain a little bit about, you know, how long it took for us to put together this book. You
right.
Chat a little bit about it.
Go ahead, Mary.
Sure. It was definitely a long period in the making, a generation of years, but the last 2 years after we visited Guam, we really wanted to put our foot down and really get this project rolling. And so after we visited Guam, my mother-in-law passed away, and we really wanted to capture something that was so precious for our kids. And we realized that our story is very similar to the stories of many who have left the island and who would like to also capture these beauty, the flora, fauna, the food, the language, and keep it in a book. And so as we're thinking about that for our children and their children, so many individuals also felt that this is so important for them as well. And so the food, so many times we experiment and we call our relatives and we try it out, test it out. And every single one of them has to like pass, okay, we did it right this time after trying it out for 7 times. We have to test it again with the same, because we don't use measuring cups, right? We just pinch, throw,
yeah.
Taste it again. Wow. And so it was really, really difficult to translate everything into measurements. So it was a huge undertaking, but we're so happy that we were able to do that.
I remember trying to get a recipe from my late grandma. This is when I was obviously much younger, and I was something like, how much flour do you put in? She's like, oh, like this. Like, what is that even? I mean, how do I scale like your hand to my hand? And yeah, it's like that. That's all. You're good. But they're so protective with the recipes. And I know you guys know that we did a cool little commercial for this cookbook with Tan Chai, you know, that was I think it kind of just embodied exactly what you were talking about, is how many times people been in the States, especially maybe the generations that weren't like in the kitchen watching Nana and Tata cook it. But they wonder, like, for example, how do you make chalaquiles? I don't even know where to start. And so there is that frantic call that you make back to Guam or your most, like, Chamorro relative stateside to get the details.
So true. And what's kind of interesting is that when we went back to Guam, part of our effort was to try to do as much due diligence to design this cookbook. And we spoke to a lot of different people, formed a lot of focus groups to try to understand exactly what they're expecting out of it.
Right.
Not only the locals, but also statesiders, when they looked at the manuscript, we wanted to kind of get a sense for how can we make it relevant to them too? Because most of the cookbooks that were developed over the last 50 years for Guam was generally for the Guam audience and not necessarily for the stateside audience.
Right.
And so I actually was in Shirley's down in Iguana, having breakfast, and I leaned over to an older Chamorro, probably in her 70s, and I said, "Hey, are there any Chamorro foods that you've never tried making and you want to know how to make?" And she was like, "Ay boy, I don't know how to make Redzenu, and I don't really know how to make chilaquiles." And I scratched my head and I said, "Wow, there might be an opportunity to sell this book to somebody here on Guam because of that."
Right.
And that was an anecdote, right? An example of where, you know, you can't just assume that everybody on Guam knows how to cook Chamorro food, right?
Right.
So
yeah.
We felt that where we are today with having this book in over 3,750 homes today is a testament for what we are doing to share the culture. And Mesh Chamorro is truly something that is near and dear to my heart, even though I'm here in Denver. I really truly want to see other people share the culture with their friends and family, whether they be in the States or in a foreign country. And I look forward to being able to give a few cookbooks out for the month of March.
Right. And we're gonna actually do that, guys. So all this week, DM us, hit us up in our DMs, Jay. Send us any pictures of any recipes that you've done from this cookbook or of Chamorro food, and then we'll name some winners on Friday. But I wanted to get back to what you talked about with this cookbook and being able to sell it to Chamorro people, which you definitely have done. But I also follow you guys on Facebook, and I see that you're getting like big orders for like Canada or, you know, Amazon or places where are not necessarily like Chamorro or Guamanian marketplaces. So what has that kind of been like?
It's interesting because what's happening is we have people who know about our cookbook walking into these boutique bookstores in New York City, right off of Central Park, in Washington, D.C., right out of the cap, right near to the Capitol, and they're actually asking the owners of the cookbooks to carry our book in the stores outside of the norm, right? The norm is Texas and San Diego and Washington, right. But to have our book being requested in Connecticut and in New York City, right by Central Park, is testament to the kind of quality that we're putting out there. As a matter of fact, the owner of the New York bookstore actually contacted me and said that their most prized cookbook collector that they all look to for recommendations actually told them about this book. I don't know how she found out about it, but when she told the owner that she collects over 2,000 cookbooks, she said this was one of her best cookbooks ever. The owner was very convinced, and he called me up and said, "Hey, I got to get your cookbook." And so they've been ordering from us regularly because they're selling out every time we send it to them in New York.
That's cool. And like I said, I mean, this was just, I felt like it was really wide open for the taking, because we have had other cookbooks, you know, locally in the past. But I mean, we're talking like the old one, Jay, with the spiral binding on the side. I forget which one that is. You know the one I'm talking about, right?
Yeah.
So this was kind of something like you kind of think like, damn, it hasn't been like a Chamorro cookbook in like that long. So really a slam dunk, and just the production of it too. And I want to go back to that. It is definitely a far cry from a spiral bound spine. This is like pretty high end, man.
I don't know if this is going to come out looking like it's opposite. It's not mirrored.
No, it's good. You're good.
So I just want to let you know that right now we're actually working with a group out of India that is a partner with Oxford Press, and they're working to help us to get our book digitized as a picture book, because our book is very colorful, as you can see, and we don't want it as an EPUB book because we're going to lose a lot of the formatting. So we're working with a partner to be able to get this book as an ebook for the Kindle platform and the iBooks platform for Apple. And that's our next progression to get this book in the hands of people that are English speaking worldwide. And that's the next level that we're moving towards.
Well, that's a dream come true for Jason, a cookbook on a Kindle, Jay.
There you go.
Wow.
No, I was gonna say, like, you know, like Gerard and Mary, the dimensions of the book, and, you know, like, the use of imagery and the rich colors and everything like that. I mean, it doubles equally well as like a coffee table book, because I mean, it is such a conversation piece.
Yeah, we've heard that from over two dozen people, that this definitely in their minds is a coffee table book, and a lot of people actually have it in their kitchen propped up as a
But
centerpiece
don't
because
touch
they.
it. That's like one of my aunties was like, I'm don't even open it, don't touch it, don't even look at it.
Oh yeah, because your auntie would always know it. Boy, I know that's open to page 47. If I ever see on any other page, you're gonna get it.
So we're gonna give away a few this week, Gerard. Let's get out your info with the website, and maybe a little bit about the other products that you guys sell that maybe you want to turn people on to.
Yeah, so on GerardAthleyCollection.com or even ChamorroCuisine.com, you can go there. We've got coconut graters that are made out of aluminum. They don't have legs. We've got Finidini bowls with covers.
I saw that. Nice.
We do really, really well with the Finidini bowls with covers. People love them. They're just a they're one of those things that people just wanna own for their own homes. We've got thousands of products that we sell, a lot of children's books. And I'm really happy to say that it looks like the market in Guam is opening up because we're getting the retailers ordering from us now. So we're actually shipping a lot of stuff tomorrow. And as of last week, we sent some stuff out to retailers in Guam. So it looks like the things are actually picking up back in Guam, which is exciting to hear.
Yeah, Gerard, we got some comments here on Facebook Live, and people are saying they've already been gifted your book by friends of theirs.
I appreciate that. I appreciate it a lot. We appreciate it a lot. I think one of the biggest things I wanted to say, Jason and Chris, is that when we went back to Guam to take care of my mom, who was really frail for about 9 weeks, we saw the culture. And mind you, we lived in Guam. I mean, not too long ago. But when we went back, we saw the culture in action, and we saw the giving attitude. We saw the Inazuda spirit. And when we left Guam after we buried my mom, we said we have to somehow frame this culture the way it needs to be framed in a book so that we can share it with the world. Because our story needs to be told, and it can be told over and over again in different ways. We just felt like we had an opportunity to tell it in our way. And I think that if it wasn't for the tragedy that we had to experience with my mom, we would not have been showered with the love and the compassion and the giving nature of all kinds of people, neighbors and friends and family, and strangers. It was just truly, truly, very, very impactful for us. And that was really the impetus behind this book.
Gerard, let me ask you this last question here, because I remember years ago seeing, I know it was one of the kids' book in a bookstore, and flipping it over and seeing that, you know, the Aflagui collection, right? And I'm pretty sure that you had your humble beginnings, but did you ever kind of envision that it would become what it is today, where you're just offering a lot of different products? Because, I mean, it started out, I want to say, kind of small, and now, like you said, you got Kumsas, you got Benedetti bowls, you got all kinds of stuff.
Yeah, I think when we started out the business in 2012, my wife probably didn't realize what we were getting into. Today, I think I want to say, oh, close to maybe 30,000 to 40,000 products are out there all across the nation. And I think it's a testament to the fact that locals and people who are connected to the island really are looking for things to connect with. And I think we hit a nerve with people, and we're very happy and very we're very, very happy that we've got the kind of support that we got from, people in Guam and Saipan, as well as across the nation. So we really appreciate it. Want to say thank you to everybody.
Thank you. Thank you, Mary. Thank you, Gerard, for your time here. And we'll get you on Friday to give away these cookbooks, if
All
that's cool to you
right.
guys, if you're not
Yeah,
snowed
we
in.
got four cookbooks. We're going to give
Okay.
away about $250 worth. And so we look forward to jumping back on Friday.
Thank you,
How
Gerard.
about Thursday, our time?
Yes, Thursday, your time, Friday, our time.
Yep.
Right. Yes. Don't come on Saturday because nobody's going
All
to be here.
right.
Thank you, Gerard and Mary. Oh, there you
All
go.
right.
Get,
Take
can we
care,
get
guys.
that snow cam one more time?
And there you go.
Wow.
That is very, very beautiful. I mean, that's picturesque right there, but I got to admit, I would rather sweat than freeze.
Yeah, that's like the coldest love seat ever right there.
Yep.
Gerard, that is a fantastic jacket you've got on. I mean, I'm sure it's incredibly comfortable and everything like that, but I could never give up my shorts.
Well, if you really want to see what I'm wearing down there.
Yeah, yeah.
Actually,
yeah.
Yeah, you're not going to be caught with a jacket like that in the middle of Tamuning, I can pretty much guarantee. Either that or you're not happy. You're going to pass out by the time you hit like GPO.
I mean, if you do wear one of those here, people are going to be like, hey, you're making me hot. Take that off. All right, Gerard and Mary.
We're really very happy for your support. Thank you, KOM. We appreciate it.
Of course.
Thank you.
There you go. Gerard and Mary Afflegui of the Afflegui Collection, 1009. Good job, Jason.
That was a fun show. A lot of stuff today.
Yeah, and we're going to be doing this whole year look back. I want to say like the whole week, because I still want to go through some of the clips, some of the good interviews that we had during the last year. There are definitely a lot that really stuck out. And honestly, thinking about some of them, it seems like so long ago. Doesn't it?
For me, the year went by so fast.
That's what I'm saying. It's like, whoa, I can't believe that, you know, we'll talk about interviewing Carlo Branch or Crystal Paco San Agustin, you know, last year. It's like, wow, that was a year ago. Yeah. Are you serious?
I mean, there are some people that have been on their show, on our show, dozens of times. There are some people who only came on once for like 3 or 4 minutes and, you know, and are memorable.
Yeah. All right. So.